Hello and welcome to the Civ 5 Battle Royale X Mark III, Episode 29. Back again after a bit of a break last week. Let's go ahead and jump into it. With Episode 29, The Land of the Second Sun. Continental leaders slowly accrue power while the stage is being set for an even grander explosion of action with a killer soundtrack. Hey people, Lunar Needle here. Hope everyone has been doing good. I've been dealing with my own demons after moving to Toronto not so long ago with my girlfriend. Things are good, and we're hopefully safe and beginning to set down roots. No matter what becomes of me, I'll never forget what you guys did for my confidence. I have a lot of who I am today to thank you guys for. Unequivocally and forever, I love you CBR and every viewer. Enough of this happy stuff. We got a show to watch. As I write the intros last, I now have advanced knowledge to say that this part has some pretty advanced hype wars declared, and some shocking cross-continental empires begin to form. Let's get in there, just after appreciating our community member for a tad longer. What? I'm sentimental, goddammit! This comic was absolutely splendid. I always loved the idea of the leaders getting in on the show and spectacle, becoming like us, eagerly anticipating every flip with bated breath. Good times. I'm gonna go off script to just gush about audio narration. As someone with some pretty hard ADHD, I get a bit anxious around so much text, but I am perfectly fine watching someone talk for an hour about a pre-built PC from the 2000s, so having our length-form text content in an audio form I can splash into other game time is perfect for me. Honorable mentions, the official CBR3 info sheet and all the maps. You guys make narrating awesome. Thanks. Funding on the good stuff we do has been Koya, leading the ship towards the unknown with a stable website and some pretty dank memes. Toss him a coffee or three, he'll use every dollar to reinvest back into the website. This is not a request. Instead of talking about the best, let's highlight Han just to make sure the PR did all the slides. Han seemed to be more methodical in their dissection of smaller empires than most, but I wonder how they'd hold up to the international stage, especially with Turkey becoming such a scary blob just west of them. A Tuvan Han Empire would be absolutely game-endingly strong, as that combined empire with the Gukturks holding would resemble Chukchi before they began to tear through their neighbors last season with far more advanced tech. A scary thing to fear with each war declaration, each and every scene. But enough of that, let's spin the cylinder to our first scene around the former Platinese capital. Charging through the burned citadels, Kaipo sends their best soldiers and Bene di Oro, a custom house summoning great merchant, which seems suspiciously away from the Amazon in favor of the warfront. Perhaps Kaipo thinks there's money to be made by making the Red South very, very green. This war is currently Kaipo favored, helped with such a heavy navy around Catamarca in the top left of the scene, and such a heavy air force based in Buenos Aires. But this may be a long grinding assault, especially if the endless sea of ancient wooden boats flip coastal cities as Kaipo sweeps west. Peace was declared, leaving four Cree-founded cities in Arapaho's hands, while Cree took the Mojave-adjacent mountain city. Hardly a fair trade, but it's likely the best the Cree could do in this scenario, with even their capital having taken damage the turn before it couldn't fully heal. Regardless, it's time for both to lick their wounds and see who's most prepared next time, unless the Arapaho want to go east or west and start a new war. It's up to them, but if I was them, I'd carpet up and secure my grip on my new Cree holdings. Maori naval units are being slowly culled away while the Inca harass a Kokong city. This is hardly what empires should be devoting their resources to, especially with that small flotilla slowly moving towards the Kokong Naval Corps. Happiness once again proving to exist to deity AI as a few barbarian Alans spawn in, likely going to raise tiles east of Bungan Brawatha in the process. A small hiccup that'll thin out the already paper-thin Wiradjuri military. Wait, is that a paratrooper just under Winterdine's lovely icon? Oh dear, oh dear. Government time! Inca goes conservative, Kaipo is a left-leaning tribal confederacy, and the Ming are led by the healers, which is very funny considering their timely demise earlier in the season. Timor-Leste is a theological republic, Angola Workers' Party is in power, while the left bloc rules America. Chile is also led by an anti-corporatist, which has apparently made them quite popular, if their name is anything to go on. Wiradjuri is a monastic order, Arapaho is a workers' congress-led horde, while the Afghans are a nationalistic principality. Interestingly, Turkey is a progressive fellowship horde, which I can't even begin to imagine. These governments are so stupid, I love them. Zulu Romanticist Democracy Congress. That's a monarchy. Yep, seems about right. Meanwhile, Castile are led by the bourgeoisie, while Babylon is led by the people. Fitting, no? Also, the Maori died while being a patriotic society. That hurts to see. The Korea found their victory path, the Yugoslav Liberal Democratic Congress is a military dictatorship somehow, and the Bengals are led by the Democratic Mobilization Party, which sounds more like a threat than a political campaign when coming from a military dictatorship. But what do I know? The military has fully assumed North Korean and Minsagate governance. It makes sense. As the lines of administration get thinner, it would only make sense for the nation's final defenders to have a say over governance. Speaking of a one-city miner, Marc Chagall, a French-Russian modernist painter in our timeline, is in Rio de la Plata as Chilean units cross the mountains and begin harassing the city's brave pikemen. Thankfully for Marc, it seems the peacekeeping Afghan units may make capture impossible without air support. It helps to have friends in high places and accept any and all open borders agreements. But will it last? I don't think this war will exactly be over in 20 turns. The slow capture of all Arctic colonies not belonging to the Kaipo are being reclaimed as the wave of captures moves east towards the Falkland city of Mendoza. The Chilean Navy seems a bit bigger, while the Kaipo Navy, while clearly modern, is a bit smaller than I'd expected. Perhaps this is going to be a grinding slog after all. Lame. Timor strikes down the southwest corner of Australia while the army begins to close in. The Navy is currently heavily favoring Timor, while the Air Force seems roughly equal thanks to the three equipped carriers. In addition, Timor peaced with Castile. Mojave has set up the Great Firewall to reduce tech theft, and Ataturk Warlord the Beloved is such a hilarious name considering the blitz we saw a few episodes back. Raid us last again, I dare you. Our words are backed with nuclear weapons. Timor, probably. These guys exist? Wild. They've basically been Tibeted, made even better when Turkey declares on Afghanistan and completely encircles them. Is that a thing? Do the immortal gods of CBR just like keeping their fellow miners alive as pets? God, I have so many questions. Lithuania is walking in Turkish lands, meaning they're likely friendly right now with Turkey. A scary sign for Turkey critics. Maybe a Tuvan-Afghan coalition could take them down, though. Side note, look at the city defense values. Turkish Konya has nearly doubled the defense of nearby Afghan Jammu. Hell, the three-pop Turkish city of Lashkargah has no army defense, and still has as much defense as the defended Kabul. Being beloved does have its perks, after all. Alright, Tito, now's your time to actually do some damage. Konigsberg is in the red, while Berlin is in the yellow. Losing the air war is pretty brutal, but the non-stop artillery surrounding Potsdam will ensure that they flip-kill many of the units that Berlin can produce. Which they'll need to do since right now Brandenburg has a 3-to-1 production advantage that's likely growing more and more, as many northern cities don't need to produce units and can instead produce buildings to get production parity with their mainland counterparts. Mori, I was happy to see you. Especially with the dumb VTuber meme that cropped up around voting season. You're fighting a war with the 7-to-1 production disadvantage with the Gokturks, but the tech disadvantage, meaning the Mori purchasing power parity of production to combat strength, is inherently Gokturk-favored. Will we be seeing a Gokturk-controlled Osaka? Bengal have pretty balanced neighbors and a huge navy. War with Afghanistan seems logical if they can form a coalition, but they might just stall peacefully with their great stats. Mapmakers will hate drawing the Turkish-Bengal border, though. Ha! Africa looks very interesting at this time. Any empire who is carpeted has a mediocre science base. Meanwhile, the most advanced empires on Africa proper are sparsely defended with skirmishers and artillery. Research agreements might help Africa catch up, but at this point, you should be ready to be cleaning up your neighbors with paratroopers coming out, not struggling to get riflemen. Here we witness a scary piece, as one declaration of war can make a huge blob that could run away with the game. Tuva has a lot of units that could exploit Han, but right now, both need a bit more army to begin gobbling up their major neighbors. Army continues to push in, and it's not looking good for the Aussie natives as the northern front collapses in order to support the continued siege of Mungabarina. Nothing decisive, but both of these armies are beginning to show their scars. Yugoslavia began pushing their majority of their army towards Berlin. Air is very disadvantaged to Yugoslavia, though. I expect there to be heavy losses and maybe a Berlin flip. Or maybe not, especially with an Alan front line in front of Berlin, which are Lancer equivalents, staring down machine guns and riflemen. Tito should have an exit plan ready, as I doubt this will continue to be any more productive. Mali continues to prove how annoying they can be with their one-tile island city of Meknes, restricting the entire battle between Amsterdam and Marrakech. I love seeing minor and middle powers prove to be a thorn in a larger, more advanced neighbor with their geography alone. Keep it classy, Tetuan and Castile. David Crosby, an American singer who helped pioneer the California sound of the 1970s in our timeline, is currently aiding the recent Wiradjuri siege with his signature psychedelic sound. Not like I think it'll last if the Navy has anything to say about it. Oh, the paratrooper died since we were last here. F. The Falkland falls from the Chilean people by a well-timed assault on the Navy. Pulling in equipped carriers and subs to clear the seas for capture. The army seems to be held back in Buenos Aires, while the gap between Concepcion seems oddly demilitarized right now. I expect both of those to change as the Navy moves slowly around the one-tile Drake Passage to the Quiapo meat grinder. David Crosby and his escort are in danger, while the Navy begins to match in power in both the north and the south. This is a pretty solid comeback, and has successfully stalled out the war for now, but I do fear the Wiradjuri's luck is running out quicker than they'd hope. As a local Torontonian, I am proud of Prince Iritaba's construction of the CN Tower, a pretty cool building that gives +1 production and happiness as well as broadcast towers for the entire empire. A devastatingly overpowered wonder that's wasted on deity AI. Oh well, I think it looks pretty neat. Hokusabe, a Mojave city, seems to be producing gold for no reason and currently hosts the Great Firewall with some chunky 7-8 production tiles just around the city. A nice place to be honest. The shyness a few turns ago has sadly faded as the rebellious Quiapo took the Chilean city with a single Great War infantry. While there's not much to note, it's interesting how many ranged units the Quiapo have, meanwhile the Chilean army seems to love melee units. Isn't it weirdly nice to see useful carriers? Just me? Don't forget Lithuania. They've marched from Europe with 90,000 troops and a dream to do what Finland wants to do. Central European enclaves. Tons of them. Cunedan flipped, with the 6 planes stationed within destroyed in the process. The Wiradjuri are really hurting now, with the amount of valid city capturing units measuring less than 10. Officially begin sweating, boys. You're now the underdog. Tuva and Mali declare on Yugoslavia, both posing little threat in their current position to strike in Belgrade proper. For now, the goal is to whittle down the land forces of Brandenburg and hopefully snipe Berlin and sue for peace. Elsewise, this war seems like an impossible victory for Tito, and every scene further into this album, the more well-equipped Brandenburg becomes. America is so boring, dude. But why wouldn't it be? At this point, they've run out of obvious targets that aren't reliant on a strong navy. Arapaho have effectively quartered the continent, meaning the only way we're going to get a fair fight in North America is if one or more of the minor powers gang up against them. For now, America has to be boring. They have to wait. And pray. Peace! It seems the war with Tuva was enough to make Berlin and Belgrade sign a peace agreement. This is a pretty brutal peace agreement, giving back all of their original holdings and resulting in no important land gain from either side. I stand by my statement. Sakurao gets annexed by the Gokturks, pushing the line of battle further up. But with how many peacekeepers block the land and form walls in the ocean, it'll be some time before a new flag waves over all of Mori lands. NWA, a famous rapper group from Compton, California, joins the Yemeni tourism board in Hodeida, looking to attract some investment from Turkey, and I mean, why wouldn't they? Turkey is absolutely gigantic, so much so that they own a considerable portion of the Transcaucasian corridor, even if sparsely defended by modern armor and melee units in addition to some insane city defenses. Damn. Have Greenland gone full Switzerland and have accepted their irrelevant role as the world's primary ice exporter? They got a nice army that, with modernization, could help clean up other European minor nations with an impressive defended core. Fingers crossed. Well, the unit positioning, the peacekeepers, the interesting terrain, toss that out since Prince Iritaba's brought 140,000 manpower to bear down on the fragile four-city Japanese mainland natives to heal. This is going to be bloody. And if they need readings of the bullet wounds, they can use this new experimental x-ray tech developed by Wilhelm Röntgen in the ripe year of 2009. About 127.5 years too late there, bud. Musicians taking the front line resulted in a grind around the north and southern front, which has let a few tanks roll into the savannah in the north in addition to a small brigade of paratroopers. Slow going, but it's going, that's for sure. Kaipo seems to be slowly getting a grip on their new Chilean outpost, but I really fail to see a way without both of these nations bleeding their army and navy dry for there to be any significant gains. Chile even have a proper enough grade general layout, meaning all the units around Rancagua are stronger than they should be. So technically, I'd say Chile are stronger now than before. Slow going, but it's going, that's for sure. From four cities to two in one turn, it seems like it's only a matter of time until Mori croaks. RIP to those water-walking Mori units when they die. Never will that stop being funny. Kim Il-sung hits his Enlightenment era after realizing he's going to witness the empire that gave him his current capital being relegated to history. Very devastating all around, and it seems like it's going to get worse before it gets better. Collection of rust and lost units floating about. I love to imagine the entire army is just fishing right now, and it makes sense when your average city is larger than our timeline Kyoto. Paul Simon, of Simon and Garfunkel fame, sits in Uganda with their crossbowmen staring down Chad skirmishers and Killaw artillery, performing acoustic ballads to the tired soldiers while two great merchants and one great engineer just sit around without tiles to work. A weird, highly defensible nation. Plus, the antique units are upgraded, that is. Crossbowmen just aren't fit for the year 2010. Wow! That was a peace deal that could have saved Mori due to the presence of Kim Il-sung's Royal Guard. One city civs looking out for each other is wholesome as heck. But will it last? This amount of tourism is alarmingly high, causing the neutral nation of Greenland to flip to nationalist control. The amount of culture is crazy. Dang. Chad declares on the alien Yugoslavia, which usually means nothing, but it's clear that Yugoslavia has not made friends with their jaunt into Konigsberg. An alarming showcase of diplomatic negligence, that's for sure. Also, Chad is clearly positioned north to defend. Perhaps he's rightfully seeing how weak Uganda is, and is opting to defend against Ataturk's new mechanical horses he keeps going on about in the group chat. Ataturk the Beloved showcasing his new technology to the native Kievan Rus people who seem dutifully unimpressed. Wait, there's 10 planes in Polotsk, Adana, and Novgorod. Yeah, Ataturk the Beloved, my left cheek. This guy's gonna get the Hague War Crime Tribunal any percent run. And we got the entertainment with The Cure, an English rock band with Robert Smith as lead vocalist that took off in 1983, our timeline, specialized for their psychedelic indie rock. Also, Mori is a king of the bourgeoisie. Not much else to add, just thought it was funny. Today I learned Zulu are not only in the game, but not the worst nation with the city still in the game. That will go to Masagate, Tetuan, Rio de la Plata, and North Korea all being worse than this 7-pop hellhole in the bottom of Africa. Impressive, if anything. Australia is a funny place. If you can defend it, it becomes a fortress. If your opponent makes landfall, it becomes a prison. And the weird jury know they're trapped, as forces begin to concentrate on the southeast in an attempt to fight back against the overtaxed attackers. You'd be insane to favor the Aussie natives, but this is gonna last a bit longer than you'd hope. Also in Image, Mojave looks to plant a city in the cinders as Timor-Leste begins to test their population with each new city capture. God damn. Suspiciously good navy there, Yemen. Sorry about the Dark Age, though. That's gotta suck. Also, hey, we're a monarchy now. Does that make me a former king? Neat. The most LMAO of all citadels, and I know it's entirely my fault as both of these empires have my Architect of the Gods belief that wasn't removed between seasons. A pretty damn overpopulated belief I created to make forts show up because I think forts look cool results in a lot of border gore. Prussia was citadel to death due to this belief. I am sorry for that, and sorry for making this war a meme. My bad, guys. Captain Jack Stronghold sounds like a name from CBRF that slipped in when I wasn't looking. Oh, and an Ataturk amount of atomic bombs. Nothing to see here. Also, Zulu gets declared on by Greenland, Rio de la Plata, and the Arapaho. If one of them takes them out, I will die laughing. Inca takes Mantan Par from Prince Olive Yang. A war I definitely didn't remember happening, but good job for him. Inca definitely has a far larger maximum extent than anyone else in Peruvian highlands, and I'm proud of them. Oh, Mori. Why do I have to narrate the part where the Japanese civ dies? It's a conspiracy, I say. Amore, Mori. You could have been one of the best, but you went right for your rival's land before settling your own. Losing North Korea's current capital early on, before slowly settling out your name. Somehow missing Kaifeng to the Great Ming, which heavily disrupted your wartime supply lines. Cornered, and with no land to expand to other than the rapidly contested ocean, they found themselves unable to expand and succeed where their forefathers failed. Mori cannot into the mainland, but they paid the ultimate price, losing to the Mojave as our 40th place competitor. F. The sideboard lights a flame in sight of the radiant Turks as Zulu is declared on by the Muisca and Yemen, of which only the latter has a chance to take the city. Meanwhile in America, the Normans, Turkey, and also Yemen filed Form 103B in the lobby of the U.S. Embassy and had their declaration of war accepted. A shame it likely won't add to music unless they circumnavigate around Africa, but still. Arapaho declared on the wrong coalition target. A shame, but for now, America survives. I completely misread the name of that UU. Might have been said already, but their machine gun UU can move after attacking, and upon using their opium action, can culture bomb opposing players. Neat! You know, Bengal, an environmentalist military dictatorship is a funny concept. Never change. Dang, Cambodia has beaten Crosby and Canaletto. They're gonna win a culture victory, guys. You gotta stop them. Wait, what do you mean domination is the only victory condition? Marrakech under damage from angry Normans who really don't want the pirate nation to survive any longer. Units moving along the solid coastline while Marrakech begins to slowly take damage. It's only a matter of time. Is that a trireme next to those battleships, Norman, sir? And there it is! The war that will decide the heart of North America begins now. This would be the time for Mojave and Cree to form an alliance with America, but I know the AI. Apopka and Chicago are the most bone, with the mountains just west of Washington and New York providing some natural defense in addition with their pretty good navy makes them not a complete paper tiger, but it's clear who the likely winner of this exchange is going to be without any external influence. Lunar note, I didn't screen peek, a peer guess because I'm that good. Kokong pieces out quickly, likely knowing the cost of devoting resources to the naval game while there's many neighbors they need to defend against. A smart move, to be honest. Get the city and peace out. I love how there's two nests for the Babylonian sub on this map. I love using this nest for my testing, but it seems this spot is not only unoccupied, but by being flat land, any Aussie civ who cannot move their units get teleported here. Poor cold artillery. F. Note, I believe this will get teleported back. Take away your Fs. Bingo, and just as expected. The Air Force slams down Chicago to the red, but due to a really disadvantageous checkpoint, it seems unlikely it'll flip before Apopka. Also, damn, there's no planes anywhere but Cuscoquilla, and those planes would get ripped apart by the AA guns. Complete air dominance. As expected from this region's strongest, but still impressive. Seems unlikely that Tetuan will ever see the light of Africa again, as they are surrounded by fellow One City Empire Castile. I love the amount of One City unity I've seen this episode. Let's hope this doesn't end like the Mori-North Korea partnership. The city population tells the story we've been seeing time and time again. City flips, and by the dozen. The Pukeruhe Dbungambrawafa line is unbroken with 20 plus population, and the cities owned by Timor-Leste are sitting at 1 to 3 population. It seems like there's an even 14 planes on each side of the war. I wonder if Ataturk lent Timor-Leste some of his planes. Heh. Even Michael Collins of the Irish Horde is putting his foot down. The slaughter of Brandenburg citizens has made it to the international press, clearly. I didn't know a war with little to no progress would have such a lopsided consequence for the weaker empire. What did Tito do? Comment makers, we need an explanation. Stat. And today I learned Timor-Leste and Castile were at war. If you want to keep up to date with CBR, the best way to do it is to narrate an episode. I didn't even know Kilwa was at war with Zulu. Not like I mind, as this will likely give Kilwa another landfall, and end the annoyingly gigantic coalition against a 7-tile miner. Seriously, what did the Zulu do? God damn. I don't think it'll amount to much, but the Navy we saw earlier around Buenos Aires has begun to harass the eastern coastal Chilean cities with consistent but temporary captures of the border cities, with a change to even strike to Pisa in the coming turns. All look to flip back red in the coming turns. There's clearly a continental land power here in South America, but Chile's defense is oddly admirable. Good job there, Salvador Allende. The Normans locked in their holdings with a good peace deal, avoiding unnecessarily damaging the unique antiques held by the Marrakech-bound empire. Where do the Normans go next but up? If I was Yugoslavia, I'd be sweating hard. You're next, buddy. Oh, it's been a long while since I've seen the supercarrier in action. Likely sent to strike down the Mori, these behemoths are faster and more defensive than their non-super brethren, allowing the multi-continental force projection Mojave to help enforce their will on the global stage. Let's hope it's used like a unit and not an ocean-bound junkie. Fingers crossed. Oh, I thought that boat was a battleship. Oops, my bad. Well, Wiradjuri pierced the wall with the snipe of the Wiradjuri's southernmost bastion with a spare destroyer. Units are really thinning out, and you'd argue, looking to the units, that the amount of manpower is beginning to loop oddly symmetrical. Expect the wet fart of a peace deal soon ruining all of our fun. Caster's curse, as not only do these new gains not materialize, but Tupiza and La Plata both flip to the Quiapo. A substantial part of the Chilean attack force seems depleted. Amazing set of turns from Quiapo. As expected, Apopka pops as the majority of the defense force coalesces around the south of the city, while the defensive front around Chicago is breached as they push over the Canadian border to strike at the city with an embarked infantry unit. The American Navy is growing in size and seemingly moving south. This Navy will flip any eastern holding endlessly, making this a surprising war of attrition even when each Arapaho city has 5 to 6 units per. Oh, and now their words are backed up with a source. The source is, I have nukes. The Patrolling Workers Union improving their Canadian holdings seem a lot less defended on both sides, but it could go either way up here. My fear is the wave of units moving up from the American center may push through Chicago and eliminate any notions of this being a fair fight. Not gonna lie, this is hype as heck. The people have spoken, and now the nomadic horde Kilwa has embraced the power of the People's Republic and has risen up. The question still rests if the newfound belief in the people will aid the struggling middle power to greatness. Note, Yemen is officially scary with their navy. Be careful, guys. The jokes just write themselves. Seriously, it takes no effort. So much so, I won't bother. Former Mori City, now hosting nukes, pointed towards North Korea is so good. I'll leave a blank spot for you to write your own jokes. That was a nice joke. Good job. Man, I literally just learned this war existed, and yet I feel more hollow knowing it isn't happening anymore. Bummer, man. Hey, Kilwa, you gonna upgrade those privateers anytime soon? You got a good carpet and museum pieces that Yemen wants to collect for proper preservation, you know. Ignoring the random surge up to the island of La Plata, this is kind of how I expected this part of the war to play out. The flipping city of choice is moving from Concepcion to Rancagua. I wonder when Quiapo will offer a peace arrangement that Chile will accept. Wow! The Incan peace was planned, and now Kokong is crashing down on the Han people, flipping Fuzhou in a surge north. So many artillery, it harms the effectiveness of this army as it crashes into infantry hard. There's so much to analyze here, but I feel as long as the movement locks artillery focus on attacking the units in front of them, I don't think Han can properly mount a defense without losing Shun Tian and maybe Longbian. This is an insane war. Hype! Chicago and Apopka secured as the dark gray horde moves east, beginning to crash down on the gap between the Washington and Los Angeles mountains. This is going really pear-shaped really quickly, guys. The Falanteel is a marine replacement who gets extra damage for fighting a nation with a different ideology and religion. They share majority religion, and perhaps nationalism, so that may not apply. What does apply is whenever a Falanteel dies in battle, they reduce the happiness of the nearest enemy city. And considering this part opened with Barbarian Alon's pillaging, it could have a material cost to the war effort. Contrasting the act of war pillaging the world as of July 2021, it's nice to see a calm Turkish and Afghan front. A hypothetical union of these two nations would be game-ending if Turkey's dominant position didn't make them the de facto head honcho. They even share religion in this part of the cylinder. I wonder how the religion map looks nowadays. The Cantor UGP is a unique unit helping Chile deal with happiness issues coming from the long and bloody war, alongside being perfect scouting tools due to being able to enter opponents' land without war or open border treaties. Which sadly isn't going to help them in this situation, but I digress. That's a pretty messed up name though, ain't it? Mali built the nuke, allowing them to continue growing their military manpower as they begin to carpet for the coming wars to decide the continent. A smart decision from our communist imperial dynasty, Mali. God, the government and ideology mixes are so stupid. They're my favorite feature in later seasons. What's yours? The deep mountains along the eastern front means that while the numbers are mostly even with some larger carpets, it's going to take a long time and a lot of bombers to secure these cities. Pokong keeping their active troopers east of Konkyong seems like the better play, as Han seems to see a lot of their coastal holdings with most of their defense in their middle core. The only, and I mean only, thing securing Han's east is their large air force, which is likely going to be sniping off some melee ships that attempt to make landfall. Mostly stable here, with a lot of the US Navy oddly distant from the coast. Are they evacuating citizens? Cuscoela is already being blockaded and is beginning to melt as the Texan Navy moves in to silence the Floridian Coast Guard guarding the former Seminole capital. Things are not looking good for Franklin Roosevelt. Not at all. And with the presence of nukes, Chile says maybe next time to killing off Rio de la Plata and pieces out. The Kaibo Tribal Confederacy successfully added bold font to their war declarations. Let's see if that diplomatic pressure helps. Bengal also successfully adds bold font to their threats, as well as their own production of the Manhattan Project. Turkey must be exporting their method internationally. It has to be the reason for the sudden explosion in nuclear activity. Oh lord, Chile's looking very empty, meanwhile the Kaibo have a lot more units. This is far, far different from the beginning of the episode, and now with Tupiza going the way of the Brazilian natives, it's only a matter of time. The Eastern Asian holdings are under attack, as North Korea can only watch over their fallen ally to witness the plumes of destroyer exhaust fill the sky. This is time for Kokong to rise. And with that, my trip down memory lane narrating is over. It's been such a great episode, and time to narrate. Seriously, if you guys want to do this, reserve about 8 hours of time, put on a playlist of music, and just do it. Make sure you leave a substantial piece of time, because a non-zero amount of time is needed to accurately analyze what's going on. I thought Kaipo was Brazil this entire episode, up until they made the Manhattan Project 3 scenes ago. Oh well. I hope my narration was good enough to pass the sniff test. A lovely, warm love to our narrators, to our website and showrunner, and to you guys for reading. Keep it classy, guys, and I'll see you around. Bye-bye. Love, Lunar Needle, Procrastinator Extraordinaire. And with that, we come to the end of this episode. I've been in Yokel, filling in for Doc Ito while he's out. I may or may not see y'all next week, depending on how Doc is doing, but no matter what, I will see you soon, and have a good one.